Good morning. Welcome to worship. It is the first Sunday in Lent. Lent comes a little extra early this year, and so we are moving into yet another season of reflection and quietness and deep thoughts as we make our way slowly and with intention towards Easter. So welcome. A couple announcements as we settle in and gather in this place. I hope that you have found Lenten devotionals that speak to you. We have put together and offered a number of opportunities and possibilities, and there was a separate email that went out. There are printed booklets that we bought from the Still Speaking devotional that either you can pick up in the bin on the back steps that are covered outside church, or Krista is happy to mail to you. There's also a downloadable one that revolves around the poetry of Emily Dickinson, and there was a link to that in the Saturday emails. And our Christian Nurture Board put together family bags and a family devotional. So however it is you intend to make your way through these Lenten days, I hope that you have found some support and intention for that. We have one more week with Wolfboro Reads and our book, On Earth We Are Briefly Gorgeous by Ocean Vuong. That book has stirred some, I won't say controversy, but some deep and reactions and thoughts. And so one more Tuesday, and the link came out for that in Saturday's email. After we finish this book, if you want to jump ahead into March, we will be reading Bishop Michael Curry, who you probably remember from The Royal Wedding. He has a new book out called Love is the Way Forward. Love is the Way. So that's the book. It's new. You'll need to buy it, I'm afraid. But you can get it on a Kindle. You can buy a hard copy of it. And I think it will be a good Lenten read and filled with some hope as we make our way through this season. So that first gathering will be in a couple weeks. So more details on that to come. And then Sunday afternoon hymn sings with Andy and myself, 4 o'clock. We'll be happy to have you pop on and join us no matter where you are, and sing together some old standard favorites. And so I hope to see you then. Let us be in a spirit of worship as we settle into this season of Lent. As we settle into this time, let us center our hearts and still our spirits as we begin with our prelude.
Thank you. Each of us is created a precious and holy vessel of embodied love. We have been through a harrowing time since last Lent that has shattered our sense of wholeness, body, mind, and spirit, like a glass vessel fractured into pieces. Let us enter a Lenten season of recovery as we focus on Jesus, the healer of our every ill.
Vessels holy and whole,
glass begins as something whole and yet discarded. As it is tumbled by the sea, it is broken and polished until it becomes a treasured mineral gem. We do not embrace that suffering is necessary or God-given, but that suffering is a part of life. When pain comes and brokenness enters our lives, Jesus reaches out to touch and remind us of the treasure that we all are. Worthy of new life in the midst of hopelessness. In a year when pandemic has wreaked havoc on our world, we begin by affirming our journey to physical health.
Lent developed into a season of intense inward reflection and confession centuries after the life of Jesus. Yet, as we will see, Jesus encouraged people to open up about their lives, to speak truth, no matter how broken. This is the beginning of compassion for ourselves and for others. It is the beginning of healing. The Latin origins of the word confess is to study and acknowledge. This will be a season of studying how we can be a healing presence in our community. To do this, we acknowledge our need to restore our own holy vessels. Let us pray. Creator God, we are bodies fashioned by your hand in your own image, shapes and colors of diverse and immense beauty. And yet too often we have ignored the sacred nature of our physical lives. The holy vessels you have fashioned are tired and suffering, ravaged by months of disrupted rhythms and ailment. Our fragility has come into full view, and we are frightened. We cannot fathom the proportions of loss, and so we look away, sometimes even from our own needs. Help us, healer. Show us our strength. Forgive our inertia. Move us to move one step at a time toward greater care. In this silence, we sense and acknowledge our yearning for wholeness.
Let us take some time in the silence together to feel attuned and aright and to be in a spirit of prayer together. I invite you to feel a warmth begin to arise within the core of your body. It may help to keep your eyes closed. Imagine a warm orb of light deep within you. This warm glow begins to emerge from the recess of your inner being to fill and flood your whole body until your skin is glowing with it, radiating outward. You are surrounded by light. Feel this warmth wrap you as a blanket of assurance. Know this, God's love and grace surround you no matter what. You are a precious and holy vessel right now. Christ's light is a treasure given freely for you, for me, for all. So take a breath. Take a deep breath in to let this truth fill you. And breathe out with the relief of assurance. I invite you to imagine the warmth that surrounds you, extending to those who may be next to you in close proximity. Imagine it extending beyond your walls to the neighborhood, to the wider community, the church, and see it spread like a rising sun. Let it expand to all the world. Let this be our peace. Amen. If you have not already, I invite you to open your eyes. The peace of Christ is with you and also with you. During these weeks of Lent, we will be in the Gospel of Matthew, and we will review each week a healing story of Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew. We'll make our way through the Gospel of Matthew these Lenten Sundays. For this first week, we will start in chapter 8, Matthew's Gospel, chapter 8, verses 1 to 4, and then 16 to 17. And this is a healing story that I suspect, have heard many times, and is always good to hear again, even though it may stir in us questions and skepticism, and perhaps a borrowed hope. From the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 8. When Jesus had come down from the mountain, great crowds followed him, and there was a leper who came to him and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, if you choose, you can make me clean." He stretched out his hand and touched him, saying, I do choose. Be made clean. Immediately the leprosy was cleansed. Then Jesus said to him, See that you say nothing to anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest, and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a testimony to them. That evening they brought him many who were possessed with demons, and Jesus cast out the spirits with a word and cured all who were sick. This was to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah. He took our infirmities and bore our diseases. Here ends our reading. May God indeed add blessing to the reading of these words. Amen. Would you join me in the spirit of prayer? Gracious and holy God, we give you thanks for the scriptures that have been handed down to us generation after generation, for those who have taught us the faith generation after generation, and for the life and the blessing and the teachings of your Son, Jesus the Christ. Dwell deeply and richly in us this day as we consider stories of healing, stories of Jesus living in our midst, that the meditations of my heart and the words on my lips might be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, my Savior and Redeemer. Amen. Lent 2021. We are soon to cross the 1 year mark of this pandemic, of life being disrupted, of worshiping this way. I think about where I was last year, what felt possible or safe, what felt worthy of concern or worry, and then I think about where we are now. We have learned a lot and we have lost a lot. What have we learned about healing? These are weeks in Lent for us to dwell in that question. Physical, psychological, emotional, social, communal healing. The list could go on, and we will try to peel just one layer a week. It's a different kind of Lent, really. Instead of focusing on the depravity or more sacrifice, I want to suggest that we focus on the essentials of acknowledging the brokenness of this last year. To name it, own it, and then begin to attend to those wounds as we move closer day by day to the great story of our faith, to the story of Easter. So this week, our healing story is a physical healing. The story of this man who comes to Jesus and says, if it be your will, please God. When we talk about healing in the Bible, we need to contend with two things when we look to the scriptures for us to learn and to think and to talk about healing. In scripture, healing is often equated with being made whole. That's a phrase we use often in our lives of faith, to make us whole. Our modern sensibility tends to take us to thinking that being made whole means taking us back to normal. To be healed is to return to normal. But that's not exactly what happens in life or in the scriptures. Being made whole always refashions us as something entirely new. Our wounds, our scars, our brokenness become a part of who we are in this new person or being that we become when we heal. We cannot return to who we were before the shattering. We cannot return to the innocence before the loss or the knowing of pain. And in truth, maybe we don't even want to. We don't want to forget, and we learn things about our own resilience and strength. We learn a reprioritizing of what is essential and what we need or value, and it changes us. Being made whole does not mean being made perfect. As people of faith, what we preach and teach in healing is becoming something new, something that is neither who we were before, nor who we would have become without the suffering or loss or pain or illness or wound that we have endured. It's a making new of life, a making new life perhaps out of hopelessness, scholar and theologian Walter Wilson suggests. New life out of hopelessness. In his book, Healing in the Gospel of Matthew, Wilson writes this: viewed in the shadow of the cross, Jesus's ministry of healing can be seen as an extension of his solidarity with human suffering, especially the suffering of those who have been abandoned by society. The bodies of those healed, meanwhile, are marked by the power of the divine to create new life out of hopelessness. Their stories represent new chapters in the rewritten narrative of human suffering. So this Lent, I invite you to consider healing as we make our way through the teachings of Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew. I invite you both to find a way through the loneliness of suffering by aligning ourselves in these stories and testimonies of Jesus's healing. And I invite you to reconsider what being made whole means. Again, from Wilson, just as there are manifold forms of embodiment, then there are manifold forms of limits. And ways that people engage them, limits in this sense, are not seen as problems to overcome, but a reality that shapes who we are and our relationship with others, including our relationship with God. So how can we expand, friends? How can we expand the concept of healing to take into account our limits? The limits of our body and mind and spirit. The limits personally and communally. How do we do that from a spirit of compassion? Sometimes it's hardest for us to offer compassion to ourselves. So many of us hold ourselves to this standard that is unachievable and unkind and never what we would expect others to reach. Some scholars suggest even that lacking that kind of self-compassion for ourselves or others is in fact the real sin. Can we take these weeks to reconsider what healing means for ourselves with a kind compassion? Our holy texts were written a very long time ago, and we must acknowledge the limitations of the context in which they were written. The limitations of known science and medicine in those days, the limitations of known causes of weather or plague. Often it's suggested in our texts that ailments are explained by the presumption of sin. Even the book of Job, however, spells out how that is just not always the case. But we need to acknowledge that that is a dated perspective born out of limited information at the time. And yet this kind of thinking still exists in our modern world. There are vestiges of it in our conservative Christian circles all around us, and it spills out into the wider world. It's dangerous and hurtful and unsound. Now that said, there are ways that we do bear the responsibility for the pain, suffering, and ailments that some of us suffer. Think, for example, of the generational effects of asthma on populations of people of color, caused in many, many, many cases because the neighborhoods that families have been forced to reside in due to redlining or inequities of education and compensation and more have been the neighborhoods closest to pollution and toxic environments. But the sin there does not reside in the people who are suffering, the people who cannot breathe. The sin there resides in the ones who have enabled such circumstances to exist and to continue to exist. Marcia McPhee says eloquently, modern science helps us understand that illness and disease do not always happen because we've done something wrong. But we can confess the times that we have contributed to the conditions of brokenness and need for healing. If we understand sin as separation or alienation, we might frame the relationship of sin and brokenness, including illness, like this. If I am alienated from my own body, my own needs, I may exacerbate the conditions of brokenness, addiction, lack of rest, lack of seeking medical intention. If I am alienated from a sense of co-responsibility for the well-being of others, I can certainly create the conditions of brokenness, abuse, unsafe practices that affect others, carelessness. If I do not recognize the inherent worth of others, especially those who are not like me, or ignore my own complicit involvement in systems of oppression, I create more brokenness and less healing in the world. In the Gospel of Matthew, the man in this story is suffering. He's suffering from a skin disease. There's much scholarship that tries to unpack whether leprosy in the Bible is always leprosy as we currently know it. In some cases, leprosy is the word that's offered for any visible skin condition. It's the only word they had: eczema, psoriasis, hives, or anything else. But because this man's disease is so visible, the temple community shuns him. They exile him from their membership and presence. It is perhaps not hard to think of a time when we ourselves have felt left out or exiled in a similar way, like we were not good enough or not welcome. Fewer of us perhaps can imagine having gone through something as dramatic as this man's story, where we were completely exiled and then healed and reintegrated into the community that once shunned us. Why would he want to return to this community that had excluded him? What must they have offered to him that he could not find somewhere else? What kind of hope and healing do we come to faith communities looking for? What kind of community have we created at First Congregational Church, United Church of Christ in Wolfboro? What do we offer to those who come in pain? What do we offer to those who are seeking healing or touch? How do we reach out to those who feel exiled in our society and in pain? Jesus's actions in this story are outrageous, as they often are. In his healing of this man, he signals that people like this man are not beyond the reach of God, not beyond the kingdom of God, of love, nor should they be beyond the limits of intentional community of the faithful. Now, there are lots of good boundaries that communities, including ours, set. They help to keep us and one another safe. They help to create strong senses of identity and purpose and self. But we need to continually check them, to re-examine them, to reconsider them with regularity and intention to make sure they are still the boundaries that God would have us set. My friends, we are all treasured by God. We are beautiful even in and through our wounds, our scars, our brokenness. We belong. How can we help one another and others feel this truth that deeply? So this first week of Lent, as we consider physical healing, I invite you to consider this. What can you do this week to attend to your own physical healing? What can you do to welcome a being made whole in the touch and in the name of Jesus this week? A dollop of indulgence that will feel good to your body? a promise to invite gentle compassion into your outlook and sense of self. Permission to accept that where you are in your healing is exactly where you are, without judgment. Bravely asking for help from someone, whether that's a medical professional or a trusted family member or friend. Acknowledging the ways your brokenness has separated you from society, from the temple, if you will, or a community that has fed and nourished you well in the past. Imagining ways that reconnecting with that community, however it is possible, might make possible some self. We are holy vessels. We have been made in the image of God. We are broken in the image of God. We need the one who comes and offers to make us whole. Open body and soul. Healer, come. We are treasures, holy and beautiful and good. May we take upon this journey together for the making whole of us all. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Let us take a time of prayer together. If you have begun to collect some fragments of something, beach glass perhaps, shattered pottery, I invite you to put them somewhere prominent. As you will see in our email, I invite you to some ritual action each of these Sundays in Lent. And so this is I'm one of those people that has little trinkets all over the place, little treasures that I have picked up along the way. And so these are just a few that I thought I would start small this week and let that grow. Some pieces of stained glass from a church that I have served in the past. Church that I served in Portland had stained glass windows that were falling out of their frames, and it was quite ordinary and usual for us to find little pieces of stained glass on the floor as we would wander around the building. So these are just a few of those. And a couple of shell fragments that many years ago, a wonderful inquisitive child that I used to spend time with, the daughter of a friend, she would pick these up. And she would find the most glorious colors. I could never find them, but Annabelle always could. And so for a number of years, I carried these in my pockets from the walks that we would take. They have made their ways into special places in my home. So for this week, these are my treasures to hold as we enter this season. So I invite you to find those or to begin to collect them. And then to settle into a spirit of prayer together. Healer of our every ill, especially our malady of separation and fear, we come before you to make our petitions known. Hear our cries for healing of body, mind, and spirit. We know that already you are at work among us, showing us the way to recovery from the toxicities and grief of our time. As demolished pieces that are treasured when found, we trust that beauty from brokenness is possible when we seek to bind together that which is wounded. We pray especially for those who have experienced the physical loss of family and friends in the pandemic, and those who are still suffering consequences of this illness. We pray for each person who suffers in body in other ways, weariness from inactivity, or weariness from overactivity in this time. We pray for those whose treatment of maladies have been put on hold, and those who suffered isolation in their illness, whatever the cause. We pray grateful thanks for the medical staff everywhere around the world who have shown unbelievable strength and stamina. And we mourn the demise of too many caretakers and caregivers who risked their lives for our sake. We pray this day. In your love, make us whole. May we rest in your compassion. Calm the lost, weary soul. In the warmth of your love, may your peace fill our hearts. May we know the love of Jesus. By your grace, you console. Make us holy. Make us whole. Amen. And now go with confidence as treasures of God, recovering your depth of love for all and our joy of living in this world. May the words of Jesus ring in your ears this week. I do choose you. And may the Spirit hover and move and deliver salve to your spirit and a spring in your step. Amen.